tucked away on the edge of the Olympic Peninsula. The Ho tribe is about as remote as you can get in the United States. For many here, being connected meant maybe a few bars of cell service. Then, in the middle of a pandemic, high-speed internet arrived from the sky.
On Sunday morning, we had
The first thing Lisa Martinez did was update her phone.
It's kind of irritating to see the red dot on your phone all the time.
It meant Ruben Hernandez's daughter could start going to her online classes.
She was happy about it. Maybe not as happy as I was, but
it also meant
being able to connect with our grandma.
Podcasts,
education,
loan applications,
Netflix, telehealth,
homework, Snapchat,
talk with the doctors,
Google Earth. That's just something weird.
Dang, there's a long list.
With the world locked down, having the internet suddenly meant everything.
It's kind of emotional, sorry. Helping the community is what we strive for.
About 100 people live on the Ho Reservation, which is 14 miles from the next nearest town. And like millions of other Americans, internet companies have had little incentive to pay for the miles and miles of fiber optic data cables needed to serve them.
We're only 28 homes, but that's a whole community that is being left out just because the cost doesn't offset, you know.
When the pandemic hit and being digitally connected became even more important, the Ho tribe decided to try something new. They turned to space.
And liftoff.
These are Starlink satellites being launched into orbit. They're part of a project by SpaceX, Elon Musk's company that aims to eventually send people to Mars. Starlink's mission is to deliver fast, reliable internet from space. No more miles of terrestrial cables. No more telecom companies unwilling or unable to lay the literal groundwork. Just a personal satellite dish and a Wi-Fi hub, all ready to connect to high-speed internet in about 10 minutes.
There's just two instructions, and they can be done in either order. Point at sky, plug in.
Behind this is an enticing promise. Starlink will finally serve high-speed internet to the most remote, hardest-to-reach people across the country. And even though the product is still being tested, they found political backers in Washington, D.C., where interest in expanding broadband is at an all-time high. Last year, the company was awarded about $1 billion taxpayer dollars. It also got authorization in 2018 to launch 12,000 Starlink satellites into orbit.
We should be open to every technology that can help bring broadband fast, and that is definitely one of them.
But can high-speed internet from space really live up to its promise? How much of our taxpayer money should we be betting on Starlink and their unproven technology? And what happens when that money doesn't end up helping the people who need it? If you're watching this video, you probably have broadband. Broadband's high-speed internet. And it's defined as anything above 25 megabits per second download and 3 megabits per second upload. That's enough to stream a 4K movie or do a Zoom conference call without lag, assuming no one else in your house is online. According to a report by Broadband Now, there are about 40 million people in the US that can't get high-speed internet. Access is particularly low on tribal lands. When you factor in the people who have access but can't afford it, that number gets much bigger. Microsoft did a study in 2020 that showed as many as 120 million Americans are not using broadband speeds.
Your ability to access critical healthcare services, critical education services, is so tied to the assumption that people can get online. But what COVID has done is it's opened the curtains, because broadband access is not diffuse. And if you look at where it's most problematic, it is typically associated with low-income, racialized communities, indigenous communities.
The thing is, we saw this coming a long time ago, and we actually had a plan to fix it. This is the National Broadband Plan. It was released in 2010 by the FCC, the agency that regulates America's internet. It was a big, ambitious plan, even by today's standards. And at the root of it was this idea that the internet, like electricity, had become essential to our lives, and everyone should have access to it.
By now, here in 2021, we should all have basically universal access. It should have pretty incredible speed, and there should be multiple competitors available in every single market where it's available. Of course, none of those things are true.
The plan fell short on almost all of its goals, and it quietly concluded in 2020, just as we were pivoting to pandemic life. So what went wrong? Maybe an obvious thing to note at this point is that delivering broadband is expensive. It means building towers, laying wires in the ground, through cities, up mountains.
We had had people on our team doing modeling on how much would it cost to connect the entire nation with fiber. I forget the exact number. It was big.
John Horgan worked on the national broadband plan at the FCC. He says there wasn't a willingness in Washington to spend for broadband infrastructure at the time.
It's not because the broadband plan didn't tell you it would be expensive. It's because there simply wasn't the political will to do that then.
So the creation of broadband networks was mostly left to the private sector, and companies sought to maximize the return on investment.
We have broadband where there's an awful lot of people, i.e. customers, but in places where there aren't many customers, or if there's a lot of customers with a poor economic base, there's no incentive for a company to build out a network there.
There are exceptions to this. Federal and state subsidies have allowed companies to build in areas with smaller profit margins. There are also nonprofits and municipally run broadband networks that have stepped in where companies won't. But there are a lot more communities like the Ho Tribe, which were left out of the picture completely. And that brings us back to Starlink. Satellite internet isn't new, it's just been expensive and slow up until now. Satellites that beam the internet down are far away, around 22,000 miles typically. This means the signal is delayed long enough to make things like Zoom calls and online video games basically impossible. Starlink satellites are about 350 miles away. The lag is gone at this point, and the signal they beam down is much faster, making real-time interaction possible. In order to test this in the real world, Starlink initially enlisted about 10,000 people, including the Ho Tribe, for something they called the Better Than Nothing Beta. And the initial reviews have been mixed. Some have noted the signal can be blocked easily, by a tree or a telephone pole. But when it works, it lives up to its promise, high-speed internet from space. However, the launch of Starlink hasn't been without controversy. Astronomers have complained that the thousands of Starlink satellites being shot into the air are starting to congest the skies, making their jobs harder. There's also the cost. The dish is $500, and after that it's $100 a month. The Ho Tribe Council agreed to a 3-year contract with Starlink, but they didn't disclose the price. Starlink declined to be interviewed for this story. In June 2021, Musk said that each consumer package cost them about $1,000, and they're trying to reduce that. One way they're offsetting their costs is by turning to us, the taxpayers, to help them expand through something called the Rural Digital Opportunity Fund. The Rural Fund was introduced by the FCC in early 2020. It will give out a total of more than $20 billion over the course of 10 years. The first round of funding, about $9 billion, was awarded in December of 2020. That money was specifically targeted to areas with no broadband. Starlink was one of the big winners. It was awarded nearly $900 million from this pot and granted projects in 35 states. But there was a problem.
Starlink won not all of their money, but a substantial amount of money to serve these areas that are already well served.
Derek Turner works at Free Press, a policy organization that advocates for open internet and freedom of the press. Last year, he did an investigation into the Rural Fund and started noticing suspicious locations that Starlink won bids to serve, like all of these not-so-rural blocks in Chicago and these in Washington, D.C., or this highway medium with no homes on it. There were industrial parks, parking lots.
Large international airports up and down the eastern seaboard, the Newark Airport, parts of JFK, Hartsfield International Airport, the Miami Airport.
There's this target in New Jersey that Starlink won a bid to serve. If you were to drive out there and see whether they'd benefit from it, what you'd find is they already have pretty good Wi-Fi. It's not just Starlink. More than 100 telecom companies were awarded money in the Rural Fund, and Turner says about a tenth of that is going to non-rural areas. And that's because the FCC was using this map to determine coverage in the US, and it's completely out of touch with the actual conditions on the ground. The data is provided by the internet service companies themselves, and there's little oversight. It wrongly identifies spots where coverage is needed and shows areas that need internet as covered. A bipartisan law was passed last year by Congress that now forces the FCC to update their maps.
We have talked about incomplete or inaccurate broadband maps for as long as I've been on this committee, and I'm glad that my colleagues were finally able to come together and address this important issue.
Problem is, the FCC didn't wait for the new maps before they awarded the $9 billion. Jessica Rosenworcel was at the FCC when the rural fund was awarded, but was a vocal critic of it.
If you had a magic wand, you'd go back and you'd sequence this all differently. And you'd start with really good information and really good data.
It's concerning to anyone who's a fan of good governance that that money not be wasted and sent to companies that don't need that money in order to do the things that they say they want to do for rural America.
For the bids that are serving people that need broadband, there's another problem. The rural fund uses something called a reverse auction, which awards money based on the lowest bid.
I look at reverse auction as a race to the bottom.
Shirley Bloomfield represents a network of about 850 small local internet providers. She says some of the bids were so low, she doubts the companies can deliver on what they promised.
What kind of internet is being put in there? How robust is it? I really worry that a lot of them will simply throw up their hands and say, I can't afford to run it.
Looking at some of the data, especially if you think of very low bids as a warning flag, I think we could probably say maybe 10, 20, 25% of the fund is questionable. And it could be even higher than that in 6 years once companies start to default.
Many of the telecoms that Bloomfield represents were underbid in the rural fund's auction. She says these companies might charge more, but are closely connected to the places they serve and stick to proven methods, like laying fiber optic wires, as opposed to, say, beaming it from space.
You're literally gambling with taxpayer dollars to say that a technology is going to work or that this company is going to be able to provide that kind of service they've committed to.
In 2021, the FCC acknowledged that money from the fund was mismanaged, wasted on things like parking lots and populated urban areas. And they're taking steps to clean it up. They released a list of hundreds of bids that were already in default and sent letters to 197 companies, including Starlink, asking for some of that money back. The FCC says they're reviewing Starlink's response.
I think it's important we make an effort to make the changes that we're permitted to make under the law, so that the right funds go to the right people, right places. So we don't want to be in the business of awarding out millions of dollars to companies that can't deliver.
Broadband connectivity
is
an essential tool for students.
It exacerbates the achievement gap.
Commerce, economic growth, and education.
We're at a moment in the U.S. where there's renewed political will to fix America's broadband problem. In the face of a pandemic, a number of local, state, and federal programs have emerged to help build networks and make access more affordable. The Senate recently voted to pass an infrastructure bill that includes $65 billion to expand broadband.
It creates jobs connecting every American with high-speed internet.
There is a willingness to spend for new infrastructure, to spend for broadband services, to extend the reach of networks, to make it more affordable. That is unlike anything I've ever seen before in Washington.
But what's clear from the Rural Digital Opportunity Fund is that money alone won't solve the problem. That money needs to go to the right places and invest in proven methods of deployment. And loopholes and lack of accountability can lead to waste and fraud.
We made really bad choices with internet deployment. If we don't correct those mistakes and learn from them, we'll be having this conversation again down the road.
For the Ho Tribe, it was about fixing the problem right now. So they took a chance on a promising new technology, not because of its potential, but because there was nothing else left to do.
For them, 100 people is probably not very much to help, but for us, 100 people is everybody.